to thank Dr. Bhatt and your organizing committee for inviting me here. I've always come to Vietnam, but I've always been going to Ho Chi Minh for the first time in Hanoi, and I find this quite pleasant. So I hope to come again. So I'll start off my first talk, which is a medical talk, and the second one will be a surgical talk. So I'm trying to challenge Jean-Paul. So my talk is a follow-up on what he said to you, really. And it's about why erectile dysfunction is a window to really comorbidities in your system. And if you detect erectile dysfunction in the patient, you should look for other comorbidities, because ED is a harbinger of most serious disease. Now, the associations actually revolve around a thing called the metabolic syndrome. Now, what's a metabolic syndrome? Everybody's been talking about it. It's the syndrome and its consecutive diseases and erectile dysfunction share the same risk factors. There's high prevalence of this syndrome, and its risk factors have been demonstrated in patients with ED. And the severity of ED correlates with the frequency of the risk factors and comorbidities, and with glycemic control, meaning it is also a prelude to diabetes. And very importantly in this syndrome, low testosterone appears to be a common denominator for many of these risk factors. So you see, it's all coming together. Now this picture gives you the whole bird's eye view. You see this erectile dysfunction at the top? You see how it's linked to androgen deficiency, hypogonadism. It's linked to endothelial dysfunction. It's linked to metabolic syndrome. And all this will end up with vascular disease, which is the starting point for all these problems. ED is actually a vascular phenomenon. I'll show you in a minute. Now, let's look at Professor Trish from the Mayo Clinic. What he did was he demonstrated that castration led to accumulation of adipocytes in the subtunical region of the corpus cavernosum tunica albuginea. The same changes were seen in a diabetic dog model. And these fat cells led to an impaired veno-occlusive function. So you end up with ED, venogenic ED. The integrity of this tunica albuginea contributes to the veno-occlusive mechanism, which is important to prevent venous leak. And if you don't have the prevention occlusive mechanism, you lead to venous leak erectile dysfunction. Now, Shen and company showed a structural change of this tunica albuginea jacket in castrated animals. And similar alterations were observed in the hypertensive rat model by a Chinese guy called Jiang. Now, if you look at histological sections, you can see that testosterone deprivation promotes adipocyte accumulation in the corpus cavernosum. So you can see this is the control, it looks very good. And suddenly you castrate the animal, you sacrifice it, and then do a histology of the tissue. You find that these adipocytes have accumulated. Again, diabetes promotes adipocyte accumulation in the spinal corpus cavernosum. See, these are all the adipocytes. Effect androgen and deprivation again. Control A, rich, regularly arranged elastic fibers. And control B, castrated animal. The elastic fibers have been replaced by collagenous fibers, you see. So in other words, this is the cause of your ED. Now, how about hypertension on the structure of the tunica albuginea? Again, in a normal tensive rat, a lot of elastic fibers. In a hypertensive rat, lack of elastic fibers and lot of collagen tissues. So if you do cross-sectional and longitudinal epidemiologic studies, these demonstrate that there is a correlation between plasma levels of total or free testosterone and the risk factors for the metabolic syndrome. Low testosterone levels are commonly found in patients with the metabolic syndrome. Those, and also with those with cardiovascular diseases or diabetes type 2 than in the normal population. Studies have also shown that the prevalence of hypogonadism in male patients with heart problems, angina, or diabetes type 2 can be 40% or higher. So you see, the whole lot is connected. Now, we'll give you some evidence of that. I'm not talking nonsense. The Rancho Bernardo study, very famous study. You quote it, you can't go wrong. The development of testosterone, the development of diabetes type 2. So here you get testosterone levels and the correlation with BMI. Low testosterone, very good correlation. Waist, very good. Waist, hip-waist ratio, very good correlation. Triglyceride level, very good correlation. Fasting insulin, diabetes, post-challenge insulin, and HOMA, the index used. Right? They all correlate very well. You see, it's p-value more than 0.001. HDLC is the opposite. You have a high HDL. This HDL cholesterol, the high one, you are better off. Whereas the lower one, you have more risk. Now, association between testosterone and cardiovascular risk factors. Again, in a famous study called the Delitong study. Low testosterone, normal. Notice that the risk factors are higher in low testosterone, red color, higher. I mean, the triglyceride level is high. HDL high means lower risk. So, you know, this is lower. LDL high means higher risk. See, the rate is higher. ApoB high means higher risk. Association between testosterone and cardiovascular risk factors again. Low testosterone, notice fasting insulin levels is very high, very high correlation. Normal is the green. 2 hour plus one insulin, the pre-diabetic or diabetic correlation very high. And then you associate testosterone with blood pressure in the study, in the Thompson study, very famous study. If you're taking an exam, any of you taking an exam, you always quote these studies, you'll pass. These are the famous studies. Notice that no hypertension, these are the ones, testosterone very high, the green very high, hypertension, the yellow lower. You see, so low, total testosterone low when you have very high levels of testosterone, of hypertension as you get older. Free testosterone also correlates the same way. Now, how about middle-aged andropausal men when you check them for carotid atherosclerosis? That means the carotid blood vessels are narrowed. Notice that red, which is the andropausal people, have a higher degree of narrowing of the carotid blood vessels due to atherosclerosis, the red color. Okay. What about male patients with type 2 diabetes? Now again, you see, the red is a percentage of, and this is the higher percentage found in those with hypogonadism. Another one here, hypogonadism, coronary artery disease correlated. Again, very high levels, percentage with those with hypogonadism. Now, as urologists, most of you are urologists, you know that we do a thing called androgen deprivation for prostate cancer patients. So, the observations in these patients when we do an orchidectomy or medical or surgical orchidectomy, we find that if you follow them up, they have an increase of insulin resistance. So here you are, if you do a test by inducing hypogonadism by medical means, meaning you inject gonadotropin releasing hormone into them, you find that it reduces insulin insensitivity in men. This is the NHRH depot preparations we give prostate cancer patients. So here you are, this is fasting insulin baseline, 1 month, After 3 months, you see the fasting insulin has gone up. So in other words, we are actually causing diabetes to occur. Now you suppress the testosterone again in men in prostate cancer. In this study again, this leads to hyperinsulinemia. Baseline fasting total, and this is for insulin, this is for cholesterol. Notice that this red color is 3 months. 3 months time, the fasting insulin shoots up. Although the cholesterol also goes up, but it's not as badly affected as blood sugar, and meaning the insulin. Now, let's look at obesity. We talked about it earlier in Jean-Paul's lecture. Studies in obese men reveal that obese men in good or in bad health have lower testosterone levels than non-obese controls. So look around you, anybody here who is very obese. Very healthy, Vietnam people very healthy. All looking sexy and young and slim. Except this one here, look a bit plump. Better check his testosterone.
Okay.
Right. The risk of developing the metabolic syndrome and consequently diabetes and cardiovascular disease is definitely higher than in normal weight controls. Right. This Israeli also looks as if he's a risk. You better check your blood later. Now, serum testosterone concentrations in obese and controlled male subjects. Look at it. This is testosterone. It's obese. This is control. So the control, meaning sexy looking me. Alright? My testosterone is very high. You see up to here. Now, this chap here, you know, he's a very obese. There you are. This is testosterone about 10. No hope. No hope. I got hope. I give an injection of testosterone. This is my bag. Now, how about obesity on sex hormones and insulin in men? Here, again, testosterone level, free, this is total, this is fasting insulin. Notice that C means control, O means obese. So if you're obese, your control, your testosterone is very low, the rate very low. Free testosterone very low compared to the control C, the green control. And fasting insulin, your risk to get diabetes, look at it, fasting insulin is very high. In your obese. So I'm afraid all people coming from Israel, no dinner for you tonight, you have to starve so that you look sexy tomorrow. So diabetes here, yeah. Studies in diabetic men demonstrate that many of the risk factors for diabetes correlate negatively with testosterone levels. The bigger size you are, the lower your testosterone. You say you look like you are very, very high in testosterone, look very sexy there. See, very thin looking. So atherosclerosis is inversely associated with testosterone. So your risk of your blood vessels being plugged with lipids is also inversely correlated with testosterone level. Here we are. These are studies comparing variables in normal and diabetic men. Waist ratio, insulin. Now, notice that this is the rate here, very high, glucose very high. Alright, then this triglycerides very high. Total testosterone very low. And SHBG very low. So in other words, if you have all these bad parameters, then you are likely to have higher incidence here. See the, all the red. Now how about There's a test we do when we measure the thickness of your carotid blood vessels in the neck. Now notice that your free testosterone here, this is low free testosterone means higher the thickness of the plaque in your carotid blood vessels. Free testosterone here, you see, this is the value of the free testosterone, and it's lower the bigger the plaque. The carotid plug in your neck, blood vessels. Now what if you were to give a treatment? Several intervention studies in patients with visceral obesity, cardiovascular diseases, and type 2 diabetes show that the normalization of testosterone levels will reduce the fat mass, increase the lean body mass, and give an overall improvement of the risk factors for the metabolic syndrome. And its consequent diseases. So in other words, all of you, if you're worried about this, take a packet of Androgel on your way home. Now, here we are. Hormone and metabolic parameters in hypogonadal male subjects after having been given testosterone. Red is before, green is after. So red is before testosterone given, green is after. Notice that it's improved here. Pre-testosterone, before and after, pre-testosterone went up. Fasting insulin, after testosterone given, you see it drops. The hormone values also drop after being given testosterone. And fasting blood sugar, notice from this pre-treatment value of so high, they all drop to a nice half the value in the green bar. Unfortunately, medical talks are full of data. So I'm afraid I have to bore you a bit with medical data before we talk surgical later. Treatment of abdominally and obese men. How you connect with testosterone or placebo treatment for 9 months. So here we are. This is fasting blood sugar, serum cholesterol, serum triglycerides and so forth. And you notice that the purple is before, green is after. So after treatment, it went up here. After treatment here, the green went down, the blood sugar went down, cholesterol went down. This is placebo. Notice that not much change when you give an empty tablet to the patient. Again, obese men, given testosterone or placebo, here we are. After treatment, the green, notice that this horrible thing has dropped. The urinary cortisol, the stress level, the cortisol has dropped. Diastolic blood pressure from this high before treatment dropped very low. You see that? That's why Jean-Paul was giving us an unusual side effect of the new testosterone, the oral one that he talked about. When you give testosterone, you should bring the pressure down, not up. But that particular new testosterone therapy he showed earlier showed that that particular tablet has a side effect of, in some patients, raising the blood pressure. And they don't know why it happened. Because normally, you should lower the blood pressure, not raise the blood pressure. Right? And this is placebo. The placebo, of course, after you give nothing, it went higher here. Or you see, placebo will not help you at all. Now, this is a testosterone lipid level in men with hypo-PIT, treated with testosterone. Now, this is the pituitary gland. Let's say you have radiation to the pituitary gland. Then you get hypopituitarism. Now, testosterone here again, the values, notice, total cholesterol. When your testosterone goes up, you see, the cholesterol goes down. LDL-C, the low density lipoprotein also went down. And HDL didn't change much. HDL is a good cholesterol. Again here, testosterone and lipids, age-associated androgen deficiency, treated with testosterone endocannabinoid. Again, treated before treatment, 3 months later, 6 months later, 12 months later, this is testosterone, it went up, total cholesterol went down with time, LDL went down with time, and HDL again, not much change. Now, how about prevalence rates of four selected diseases studied in this particular study in the United States of America in its patients who had erectile dysfunction? Okay, this is hypertension in red, hyperlipidemia in the yellow, and green diabetes mellitus. So this is age of the patients, and this is the prevalence of ED. Notice that erectile dysfunction went up higher and higher in the older patients with these comorbidities. So if you add in the age factor, you're older, plus you have all these comorbidities, you will end up getting a higher incidence. You see, as you get older, it gets worse. Now, how about this one? Erectile dysfunction severity as related to comorbidities in this study on men's health issues. Hypertension, high cholesterol, heart trouble, diabetes, heart attack surgery, hardening of arteries. So ED here, red is none, yellow is mild, green is moderate, blue is moderate, black is severe. Well, you notice again, the severity is here on this side. Notice, very severe ones, it seems to be quite high. Many believe you have hypertension, cholesterol, and all these things. They seem to be way higher and higher compared to the red, which is none. If you are red, you are in a good zone, but the minute you have any of these, you seem to be going up. Notice. Now, how about metabolic syndrome and insulin resistance in those with erectile dysfunction? Another study, non-diabetic, blue. At the entire group is here. The incidence in the literature, this is the entire group studied. Notice that metabolic syndrome in a non-diabetic is low. The minute you have those with other problems, not the diabetic ones, is higher straight away. It's higher than the blue. Notice that. And this is the incidence in literature, which has no particular connection with one entity. Metabolic profile and severity of ED in men with organic, in this study with people with organic ED. Mild ED, here we are. Insulin resistance, here we are. Metabolic syndrome, fasting blood sugar, high. So notice that if you get this level, a percentage, but in moderate ED, you get higher levels here. Severe ED, these are even worse. So there's a linear relationship, linear, with all these conditions. Again now, this is a medical center studying sexual dysfunction. It connects the percentage of sexual dysfunction with hypogonadism, hypertension, diabetes, and coronary artery disease. Well, notice hypogonadism, 36%. Hypertension 35, DM 23, and 20% for CAD. Diabetic men, and its connection with HbA1c. Notice that this is a low HbA1c, this is a higher HbA1c. HbA1c, the highest here, is the highest percentage. So the higher your HbA1c, the higher level of erectile dysfunction you're likely to get. So it's a real thing. Again here, diabetes and glycemic control and treatment of the ED with tadalafil, which is a PDE5 inhibitor. Now, if your HbA1c is higher, your chance of improvement, mean percentage here, your chance of improving is less. You see that your this is your those treated with the PDE5 10 milligrams, and this is 20 milligrams. Even with 20 milligrams is not doing any good here. You notice as you get higher your HbA1c. Now hypertension, diabetes, or both. Now, hypertension, your diabetes, or you got both. Notice that the percentage is higher if you have both. So ED is connected with hypertension, diabetes, and you've got both, you've got a whammo. What's the odds ratio of getting ED? If you have diabetes, hyperlipidemia, hypertension, psychological stress, and sedentary life. Notice that your odds ratio is highest in your diabetes. So diabetes is the new age scourge facing the world today. So you notice that diabetes is getting more and more prominent in countries who are getting richer, eating more, like Vietnam, people are eating more now here. Last time I saw this, like eating too much, I told him, you get diabetes, he didn't listen to me. I used to work in Saudi Arabia, and in Saudi Arabia, the diabetes rate is 75% today. You know why? Saudi Arabia is very rich, they got a lot of oil. Nobody wants to work. All the workers are foreign people. The old Saudi Arabians just go there and give orders and walk around, do nothing but eat every day. They look very fat, all of them. Majority of fat like hell. And during the lunch and dinner, you can see the food. Full of food. And then one whole table of dessert. All sugar. And that's why the highest incidence of diabetes in the world, Saudi Arabia today. And diabetes means, look, what's the ratio of getting diabetes? The highest. Then your high lipids, hypertension, all contributing. But this is the biggest killer. So diabetes is the next scourge in chronic diseases in the world. So we have to prevent it. And how do we prevent it? The lesson to learn today, the take-home message is pump up the testosterone. Go to the petrol station in his clinic. His clinic has got a petrol station there that gives you the new petrol of the century, testosterone. Now, severe erectile dysfunction here. Okay, another study. Show you again, hypertension, notice that. Cholesterol, heart trouble, diabetes, heart attack, or heart surgery. So the next serious scourge is high blood pressure. Okay, Japanese men studied with type 2 diabetes. Look at the healthy controls percentage compared with diabetics here. Yeah? The total diabetics, this age matched diabetics, total diabetics. Again, the message about diabetes. If you don't prevent diabetes, you are going to get ED. There's no doubt about it. Okay. Again here, notice the prevalence of ischemic heart disease here. This is the plaque score. Notice the plaque score here. Very high. This is the prevalence of IHD, very high here. And here's a community-based study survey. Studying the presence of erectile dysfunction, or present or not present, in the people with heart disease, diabetes, the hyperlipidemia. So you have ED, more likely to get about double the incidence if you have heart disease. If you have heart disease here, if you have diabetes, more than double the incidence, and high lipids, about one third more. Well, we are moving to Middle East, Germany, where my good friend came from, Italy, Turkey. Again, same erectile dysfunction in three populations, you know, diabetes, hypertension, and diabetes combined, and this is the odds ratio. So, everywhere in the world, they're all having the same problem, in other words, not just one particular group in the world. Now, organic or psychological etiology, ED. Hypertension, there you are. Abnormal glucose, there you are. Type 2 diabetes, borderline diabetes, coronary artery disease. So hypertension, and in this particular study, it was more, hypertension was more serious than diabetes. But these two are kind of the main killers. And another study, now bringing to another factor for you to understand, that in metabolic syndrome, there's one common factor. The common factor is endothelial function. Your endothelial tissues in your body go into dysfunction. So here we study endothelial function score. CRP is a measure of sudden death or dying, the risk of dying in men with metabolic syndrome. Metabolic syndrome got many factors in metabolic syndrome. So you've got 3, 4, or 5 components of the metabolic syndrome here. So here, if you have 3 components, this is your risk factor for ED. You've got 4 of the components of metabolic syndrome, you've got this amount. 5 means you have this amount. So the higher, this is endothelial function score. You see, so your function gets worse as you have higher the number of components of the metabolic syndrome. The risk of dying, CRP, if you have greater number of components of the metabolic syndrome, the higher your CRP and your risk of dying. And hypertension rates here, non-ED, ED. You see, hypertension is a real problem. So everybody that walks in the clinic, whether you are a urologist or not, whether you are a surgeon or non-surgeon, unfortunately, to pull out that BP set and take the blood pressure of that male patient walking into your clinic. If you are lazy, you can buy the digital one, you grab the thing around his wrist or his arm, and then the electronic battery operated thing will measure it for you. But you have to do it. Whether you're going to buy the electronic or the manual one, you have to do it. I picked up so many patients walking into my clinic, and I just, on a suspicion, measured the blood pressure. It's ED. Measure pressure 180 over 118. This is exactly what the problem is. Undetected hypertension. Now, here you are, again we are talking about diabetic and non-diabetic with ED. Notice that age is here. As your age goes up, and you're diabetic, your chance of getting ED is very high. Here's a normal person with normal blood sugar. And this fellow is a guy with a high fasting blood sugar. So, as your age goes higher, your chance of getting it is much higher. And all ages is still same. The diabetic is a higher chance. Right? So, basically, this is basically what I've been saying. So, again, this is the odds ratio. So, I'm going to summarize and end it quickly so we can have question time. So, I'm going to end my talk quickly by giving you a bird's eye view, okay? Okay? Now, I mentioned to you that the common factor in the metabolic syndrome is that you have endothelial damage. Any vascular structure in the body has got endothelial lining. This is damage. And how is it damaged? It's damaged by smoking, by hyperlipidemia, diabetes, hypertension, angiostenosis, plaque rupture, thrombosis, arteriosclerosis, erectile dysfunction. You see, they all share the same common factor. And this is the factor for metabolic syndrome. Now, another cartoon to show you, a take-home message. ED shares endothelial injury with other conditions. Diabetes, dyslipidemia, tobacco, hypertension, they all give rise to a condition called oxidative stress. This causes endothelial cell damage. And then that leads to atherosclerosis, thrombosis, erectile dysfunction, vasoconstriction, hypertension, and what have you. So, now you know why ED is connected to all this. So ED is the window to the conditions. So anybody coming to your clinic with ED, you must check the blood pressure, check for diabetes, and the whole damn lot. Now, this picture is the same picture that Jean-Paul showed you earlier. If you come to a doctor with ED, this is your blood, your artery to your penis, showing it is getting narrow. If your artery to your penis is this narrow, imagine the artery to your coronary blood vessel is that narrow. The artery in your internal carotid artery is that seriously narrow, and the femoral artery is that badly narrow. So this